you know, I want to, before I go into more detail, I just want to say, what is eco-socialism? We should probably linger on that point a little bit. That's a, in the title of the book. And there's a video online you can see of Joel Kovel in Belém, Brazil, in 2009 at the World Social Forum, 2008 or 9. And he says, what we're saying here, he's like standing in the front of a room with Hugo Blanco and Michel Lowy and these other big intellectuals is, and activists, as he said, this is not just an idea. It's the most powerful world-transforming idea that now exists. And now we got to get organized around it. And so I'd like to sort of put that out there, that think about that, that this might be the most powerful and world-transforming idea that now exists, not because we think we're so cool, but because because of the force. So we hear Mother Earth crying stronger and stronger every day, and the more we hear Mother Earth crying and shaking, the more we eco-socialism becomes the most obvious common sense solution to the world's many problems. Since this, the first essay in this book is from the 1990s, I believe. Mm-hmm. Since that time, organizing has happened. Since that Belém gathering I just mentioned, this book is dedicated, in particular, I want to mention, to the first Eco-Socialist International, which was constituted and founded in 2017 in Venezuela. 19 countries came together with 100 delegates from movements, not just intellectuals, but delegates from movements came and constituted and made a plan of action. So we've now, we're in our second year of operation of the Eco-Socialist International. And I think now that, especially now that the action is really taking place and the organizing is taking place, it's time more than ever to sort of return to the theory and be clear about what we're talking about, because as any powerful idea becomes more popular, more fashionable, there's always the risk that we lose the content. And we miss this really, what's really world transformative about this. And that's why we need to go back and read some of these early essays. I just want to give you a sense about how this idea that Joel works on at his desk quietly in upstate New York has ripple effects around the world and finds fellow travelers around the world.
Bueno, cuando conocí a Joel y Quincy tradujo en una conversación.
When I met Joel and I translated a conversation for them.
Yo sentí que Joel tenía como dos preocupaciones muy fuertes.
They both had two very large worries.
Una era que se incorporara las viejas ideas de la discusión del comunismo, el socialismo y el ecosocialismo, que se incorporara el comunismo originario, el aporte de las comunidades originarias ancestrales de América. Esa era como una gran preocupación.
One of the big preoccupations, worries, was how to bring into conversation, how to unite, how to keep in touch both the history of communism, the Marxist history of socialism and communism, with also the original communism of the original indigenous peoples in all the continents who had an alternative way of life where everything was held in common.
Y la segunda cosa que me parece relevante de la vida de Joel es que no todos los seres humanos pueden cerrar ciclos.
The other thing that really I want to say is that about Joel is that very few human beings in the world are able to close a cycle.
Y Joel tuvo un sueño grande, más allá del amor hacia los otros seres que amó, tuvo un amor por la humanidad también, por la idea de la tierra y del ser humano.
So he had an idea, he had this big idea that was beyond, a bigger love. It was beyond, I mean, he had the individual loves with people in his life, but he had a bigger love for humanity, for the world in the at large.
Y antes de morir, Joel vio ese sueño culminado, porque independientemente de que no pudo estar en Venezuela para la primera internacional, la gente que él impulsó como buen maestro cumplió esa tarea.
He had a big dream, and he was able to live to see it fulfilled. Even though he couldn't be there in person, he was a good teacher, and he formed his students like a good teacher. And this Eco-Socialist International was convoked and founded within his lifetime. He wasn't able to attend because he was sick, but that happened within his lifetime.
Y yo creo que es muy lindo que cualquier ser humano pueda cumplir sus deseos de cerrar sus sueños mayores.
And I think it's a beautiful thing for all human beings to think about accomplishing their greatest dreams, to be able to close the cycle that they first set out on.
Wow.
Gracias.
I wanted to ask maybe if Kanya, so my wife Kanya, who also worked very closely with Joel, wrote the introduction to this book. There she is.
Going through Joel's essays, we were sort of, it was occurring to us how much Joel really valued and was so exacting with his theory and his scholarship. And the reason he could stand behind ideas that made him at times extremely unpopular and really, you know, really caused some strife in his life was because his scholarship and his research had been so exact. And I feel like, as Quincy was pointing out, we were discussing that there's a tendency and maybe a desire for us to shrink things in this age where people don't even read beyond the headline often, let alone books, right? But Joel's, this book of essays and Joel's work in general, I feel like really inspires me at least to keep pushing for the kind of academic and scholarly engagement that Joel stood for, and not in sort of a stuffy armchair way, but just so that we can be better activists and better organizers and better, you know, people who are part of movements. Because without this kind of scholarship, without the dedication to sort of clarity of ideas that he stood for, we're going to constantly be unclear about what the vision is, what the end goal is, and what a successful movement might look like. So that's just what I wanted to contribute and what I felt as I was writing the introduction. So, okay.
One of the things that I really appreciate about Joel was his openness to so many different kinds of understandings of the world. That is something that, unfortunately, I have to say, and a lot of the left have not seen. And to me, that's been one of the paradigms, you know, to follow. So, okay, so I want to share with you, because what is ecosocialism? What is this concept about? And Joel worked at this, whether consciously or not, as you pointed out so rightfully, for easily like a couple of decades before the term sort of came into being in some respects. So he was steeped in a lot of the socialist traditions, including Marxist traditions, but he also read much more widely with respect to socialism. So that's kind of reflected in this collection as well. So one of the things that I guess perhaps could, there are many ways of summing this up, but this one for me kind of works, and I'll share it with you. There are many definitions of socialism. This came out, let me just give you a little bit of background about this. This is of five theses on eco-socialism. I believe we have this in our Eco-Socialist Horizons website. If you're interested, we have quite a bit of material as well that is related to Joel's work. So this actually is not an article that was published in Capitalism, Nature, Socialism, nor any other academic publication. This came out of all the work that Joel did with me, with Quincy, with so many people in activism and much more so than in the academy. So he says on page 240, there are many definitions of socialism and no magic in this name that has been rather beaten up by history. But for the purposes of an ecological transformation, socialism cannot rest at being a social democracy where parliamentary reforms blunt capitalist force, nor will it be workers' power as transmitted through big unions or massive bureaucracies, nor a party state where the party stands in for the collective producers. These are at best transitional stages that ossify and occlude the actual power of socialism, which can be only one thing. The power, this is coming straight out of Marx, by the way, this is the power of freely associated producers. In other words, the actual overcoming of capitalism's deadly grip over human creative power by reuniting producers with the means of production through a redefinition of productive property along communal lines. This is actually not just Marx, in fact, it's much wider than Marx, as it turns out. That could be something to discuss if you're interested.
Thank you all for coming.
Thank you so much to the
Inquiring Minds. Thank you, Inquiring Minds.
And buy the books through the bookstore. And you-